today I am going to show you a surgical technique of KY fixation of supracondylar fracture in a kid. These fractures are extremely common in 5 to 7 years age group. Today's patient is a 4.5-year-old girl who unfortunately fell and has got a type 3 supracondylar fracture. So if you see, this is completely displaced, this has gone posteriorly and medial. So this is posterior medial type of a supracondylar fracture, which will be Gartland type C. So I'll take you through how to do a close K-wiring for these injuries. So now in terms of positioning of the patient, the kids are usually small. If you keep them at the head, top of the table, this arm won't be lying on the hand table. So the key is to have the kid way across on the side of injury so that you can get a good x-ray while doing this procedure. So our patient is on this side, so C-arm will come from the opposite side and the screen will be there in the front so that we can see it all the time when we are reducing it and when we are passing the wire. So now we are ready. The patient is prepped and draped. I never use a tourniquet. One thing you want to examine is you feel here to see if there is any, you know, you feel the bone, or if there is puckering of the skin, that means the fracture fragment has gone through the brachialis. In that case, you will have to milk it to dislodge it before you attempt any reduction. So for this operation, the most important aspect is to get a good reduction. So the first step of a good reduction in order to dislodge the fragment is first a longitudinal traction. So my assistant, Dr. Kushwant, is applying counter traction and I am applying traction, and I can feel dislodgement of the fracture fragments. And once this is done, you do it for a few minutes and then take an AP x-ray to see if it is reduced in coronal plane. So after applying traction, you see there is improvement in its position, but still there is still some room for improvement in terms of reduction in coronal plane. So next step in reduction is, now this is still slightly posterior medial, so I'm just going to reverse the forces and see if it makes slightly better. So I'm just trying to correct the coronal plane deformity in the same position. So I'm just trying to push the proximal fragment slightly medially and let's see if it makes any difference. So now you can see after reversing the forces, the reduction is much better. So now I am in a position to start flexing the elbow in order to correct the deformity in sagittal plane. So to correct the deformity, you put the hand on the olecranon and then flex and pronate the hand. So after pronation, we are ready to take a tangential or Jones view. But the key at this stage is don't hyperflex. If you hyperflex, then you can damage the posterior periosteum and it can make it unstable. And also, if you hyperflex, the ulnar nerve can sublux anteriorly, it can be in your way. So let's take a Jones view and see how it looks. So this is the Jones view. Just to explain, this is the lateral supracondylar ridge. This is medial supracondylar ridge. This is the fracture fragment. So still, there is medial displacement of distal fragment in comparison to lateral side. So if you look at the Jones view, if it is nicely reduced, this is how you will see nice contour of medial supracondylar ridge, lateral supracondylar ridge. However, now whatever we are seeing on the view I showed, the medial, the distal fragment is gone medially. So all I am going to do is to push this fragment inside and this slightly outside. The books will describe that you have to do this in extension, but one thing that I will tell you, if you flex it, then the posterior structures are tight and you can translate it millimeter by millimeter. So just apply a little force and you will see slowly this is aligning well. So the key is that you correct residual coronal plane deformity when the elbow is in flexion, not in extension. So just I'm pushing with my thumb and gently I'm translating the distal fragment slightly laterally and shaft medially, and you just need gentle force, you don't need a lot. And then we are going to take another view and let's see whether it has improved. So now if you see, as shown in the previous picture, in which there should be, when the reduction is perfect, now the contour of medial supracondylar ridge as well as lateral supracondylar ridge is pretty anatomical and looks very good. And if you look at before, this was translated medially. So the key is, if you want to reduce it in flexion whenever you have got any residual deformity. So after taking the Jones view, you do take a lateral view and you see this is nicely corrected. There is no rotation. So now we are in a position where we can start firing the K-wires. Now people talk about keeping, you know, hand in pronation if it is posterior medial and supination if it's posterolateral. This is just a textbook description. You will find that this is not always true. So in sometimes you will find the fracture is stable in pronation and sometimes it's in supination. So don't be rigid in your mind that if it is posterior medial I will pronate and if it's posterolateral I will supinate. So you may have to vary your clinical practice. So the first wire that you always pass is the lateral wire, and you should use no less than 1.6 mm wires. The British orthopedic guidelines, the Bose guidelines suggest that you should try to use 2 mm wires wherever you can, but the minimum is 1.6 mm. So once you are ready to pass your wire, always put it with your hand, feel the bone and then check it on your x-ray to see if it's in good position. So the position looks pretty good to me, so I am in a position to start firing the wire. So once you pass the wire little bit, check it in lateral to make sure that it is in the right direction. And if you look it at lateral, it is a touch anterior, but I won't mind that. As long as it is following the center, or it is following in the line of the medullary cavity of the humerus, I'm happy with it. So you'll go through the medullary cavity and then you start resistance. So now I'm hitting the second cortex and then you will find a giveaway. That means the wire is gone through the second cortex. So let's unscrew it. So people struggle to pass the wire, and on this occasion we have passed the wire on just first go. We didn't take even a second attempt, and the reason is I imagine my hand in my head where the humerus shaft is. So this is humerus shaft. So I have decided my point of entry on AP is this. On lateral I will just have a look that what will be my direction so that I am in the center. So once in your mind you think that you have to go here at the center, you can angle it, angle your drill in a way that you are passing wire in a perfect position. So always imagine in your head where you want to go, and this will help reduce the number of attempts that you will take to pass the wire in perfect position. So now we have passed our lateral wire and it looks pretty good, and both on AP and lateral I am happy with the position of the wire. Now people are there who will say you can put two lateral wires or, you know, cross wires. I am a fan of cross wires, especially in type 3 fractures, because it's biomechanically much stable. So once you have passed the wire, lateral wire, you can actually extend it, and you should pass. If you are using a medial wire, then you have to extend the elbow before you attempt to pass the medial wire. Otherwise, you will increase the risk of injury to the ulnar nerve. So always extend the elbow before passing the medial wire. So now I have extended my elbow before I pass my medial wire. And if you look at the CR images, the reduction is picture perfect. So now I am holding the wire in the hand and I am checking on the CR. The position or the entry point looks pretty good to me. On medial side, you are always better off making a small stab hole, dissecting with a fine artery clip before you pass the wire onto the bone. Okay. So I've just made a small stab hole and I've just passed my artery forceps. I am onto the bone. Now I am happy and my elbow is extended. The ulnar nerve is behind and I am now happy and I feel pretty safe to pass my medial wire. So one key tip when you're passing the medial wire is, if you want to go posterior or anterior, always stay slightly anterior. If you are anterior, chances of injuring ulnar nerve is little. So if you have option between going slightly anterior or slightly posterior, be touched slightly anterior. So now we have passed our wires, and if you look at both AP and lateral, it looks pretty perfect. The anatomical reduction and rigid fixation. Always, once you have fixed it, what I do is I always do a dynamic screen to check the stability, whether your fixation is good. If you are worried about your fixation, then this is the time to check. Otherwise, there are chances of fracture displacements are very high if your fixation is not strong. So now if you see here, I am doing flexion and extension and it's pretty good. So now I've cut the wire. This is AP, this is lateral, this is perfect, excellent result. So viewers, this was a video on how to do a K-wire fixation of supracondylar fracture. For trauma surgeon, it is one of the most difficult cases to do and people sweat before doing this case. However, I am sure this video will help you in doing this case. I almost never have to open this, and most times the surgery finishes between 10 to 15 minutes from the start of the operation. I hope you like this video. Do subscribe to our channel and do share this video.